Hello, everybody. Welcome to Convict Corner for Wednesday, the 9th of May. I'm your host, MJW006, with my trusty co-host, Random Chew. How are you, buddy?
Good, thank you, Matt. I'm glad that I get the co-host tag and not sidekick. I was very appreciative.
It wasn't me that called you a sidekick. It was, whoever the guest was.
I think it was Bogan.
Bogan, that's the one. Sorry, he's a nobody, so I don't even remember what his name is.
Yeah. Bloody Bogan.
How's your week been, mate?
Well, as you would well know, we're a couple of days into Scoop. So I've been living off 5 hours sleep for the last few days. I haven't slept properly since, what's the day today? Today is Wednesday, probably Saturday night, where I declined an invite to be social and decided to sleep instead. But no, I'm looking forward to the next 2 weeks. There's a lot of big prize pool tournaments out there. Hopefully I can just do an Isildur and win a couple, get some bracelets, and then I'll be very happy.
Yes, I think anyone would be very happy if they knocked out the results that Isildur just whacked out.
What a beast. Like someone who's that, I know you're trying to do a show intro, but I just want to quickly tangent before you do all your admin tasks. What a beast. Like the guy comes in, there's been a bit of question about like his tournament game and you know whether his high aggressive nature would like translate into MTT success. But he goes off and binks like probably the biggest or like one of the biggest like tournaments, like the Sunday Million equivalent, which is with a softer, a slower structure, it's a bit less of a minefield. But then to double it up with the 500 rebuy, one of the toughest like Scoop tournaments, that's very impressive. Yeah, very impressive.
And I don't even think he's a winning like six max player lifetime.
Well, you'd think he'd be like a very good. Well, obviously he's kind of cemented himself as being a top MTT player to be able to, you know, conquer that field. But I don't know. Maybe it's just excessive variance. We'll see. He's probably sucking up all those pots that you were supposed to win. Like the equity is just like somehow gone into his account, and that's why you're losing.
No, I mean it's been pretty sick. And for those that are listening that aren't actually aware, like I mean, I think most people would be aware. I mean, he's just binked off event one and event three, four,
which is insane. Like,
yeah,
that just doesn't happen.
Some like outright people, wins as well. It's not like he, you know, like won one and came third in another, which, you know, would be notable as well. He legit outright won. And, I mean, this is one of the things we were talking about last week with King St. Pauli, who won, like, four major tournaments on the one day and how sick it is, like, to not just final table four major tournaments, but to outright win four major tournaments. And really, really sick to be Scoops. And as you just mentioned, like, some really tough fields as well, like the 2K 6 Max and the it was the 2K full ring, wasn't it?
No, it was the, yeah, it was the Sunday.
And the 500
replay. Sunday Million was on, yeah.
Six Max, yeah. So really, really sick effort. How's your poker going, mate? What's going on in the land of Chew? Any results, or are you still just binking off like a 3-4K score every day?
A bit of that. Today was, I played the 1K today, which was, I was actually looking forward to it, probably the tournament I was looking forward to most other than the main.
Except you spewed.
Yeah, except I didn't do well. I managed to just spew away my stack and then doubled up and then spewed it away again. The structure was something, that slow of a structure was something I wasn't really, I forget how like good the structure is at Scoop, so I don't have to be as, I don't know, reckless. And I was a bit too silly. I could have been a bit more calm. So I think that was one of my flaws approaching the tournament. So going into the next big Scoops where we have the good
I think you also played a hand that I think you would normally 3-bet in any normal situation that you maybe didn't just, maybe you were a little out of your comfort zone or something along those lines. I don't know.
I don't know if you're trying to needle me here.
No. I really think, like, after thinking about that a little more, I really think that that's a hand that you 3-bet, like, almost all.
So, what, me personally? Or
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it's just because it's a slower structure, though, so you can afford to flat more. And in such an aggressive, like, tournament where it is a 1K buy-in and, then, like, pretty much all the people playing were decent regs or at least aggressive amateurs, people were, like, squeezing a lot. So my kind of plan was to flat And
I mean, I got in a gazillion big blinds in the first level with like ace king of spades on like jack 10 of spades 6x for like infinity. And
rat. Oh, so you got it in with like a good edge, is that what you're trying to tell me?
Oh, I got it in with a gut shot straight flush, royal flush draw against top two. So, I mean,
oh, so you got it in with the nut flush draw and a royal flush draw,
yeah, but like, I mean, I like.
Wow, you're brave, mate.
Anyway, well, I mean, it was. It's kind
you're,
of
you're
it,
sick.
I mean, it's kind of. I mean, it's kind of similar because you're only 50 BBs deep at that point in time. So, I mean,
it was verse. It was verse.
Under
the gun open, and it was Pisagno who is going to hood flat like.
Yeah, which is good. That's a positive thing when you have ace king.
Definitely, but then again, if I can, if I flat, then I can kind of induce a squeeze from someone behind, and then. Get more chips in that way rather than to like free bet and then get Pisagno to flat and play all stack.
Very ambitious. I think,
well, no, I, as I said, like I do three bet there a ton as well. Yeah. So, and you know that we've had our big all our
theories. I personally, I just think you're being a bitch because you were playing a 1k and
that is so, not true. Dude, did you see just, me? I was playing against one of my like the most loved poker personalities going around. The 99 Never Loses, who I'm a big fan of. His Facebook game is absurd. I hear it called him down like two streets with like, I think third pair. And I was willing, I was nearly going to call a river depending on like what it was and like a few different things. And yeah, I wasn't good. And he won a pot and I cringed. And I'm like, that sucks.
That's a very cool story.
Thank you.
All right, let's. We have a special guest tonight. We have Sean Callender from Poker Media coming on to speak with us tonight. So before we do that, we're going to jump through and bounce around the local happenings, if that's how we'd like to put it, as we usually do. And first of all, we'll jump into the online results. Today, actually, the $82 heads up scoop today. Australia captured its first scoop title for the year. Joe to the Joe, who we don't actually know the identity of, only a screen name. He wins the $82 heads up scoop today, the medium, for $31,000. Congrats.
Nice effort.
Yeah, so very nice effort.
How did you feel? I know that you played the $700 heads up event today because you're a real boss. How did you feel the quality of play was this and the field and that kind of stuff in a heads-up scoop event?
It's a little different for me because I do come from a heads-up background. So, like, that was kind of my... like, if there's ever going to be a time where I have an edge on, like, all the MTT bosses, it's actually that tournament.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm very comfortable in that scenario. I like, the field's good. Like, and I always used to look forward to... There was like the one event on the scoop or the F-tops or the W-Coup schedule that I always looked forward to because coming from playing heads-up sit and goes, it's just like right down our alley. So not so much the W-Coup because the structure is normally deeper in the W-Coup than it was in the scoop today. And a lot of the heads-up cash guys tend to do to have a significant edge in that one. But against like MTT players and like this is, you know, I'm one of them now. So... you know, generally they haven't put as much effort into their heads-up game and the way that ranges change or even just like deep stack post-slot play as much as you have to as a heads-up player. So that's typically where your edge comes in a tournament like that. So I always feel like the fields are good.
You did dispatch a few... Oh, I don't know, I think my computer's... micro. There it is. You did dispatch a few big names in the heads-up event today. Would you like to list a couple of your scalps?
I think you're thinking of DJK, and he's the only one I can remember. I don't even remember who else I played. I ended up losing to UH Big Tex. But yeah, I beat DJK in round two. I think I got lucky, actually.
Matt did go on quite a bit of a run and had quite the rail going on. A lot of the Australian community was railing him. But, yeah, he's a match against DJK. And for those who aren't MTT regulars, DJK is a, I'd like to say, adopted Aussie now, but he's a former American living in Australia and one of the best online tournament players in the game, regarded by many as the best. So for him to claim victory over DJK goes to show that our boy MBW actually does have some skills.
So yeah, no sample, how much sample sizes. All right, sick needle. So during last week, Michael Wagen Wars Faddison, Fadzy, as Random Jew likes to refer to him, won Pokerfest Event 38 for $18,000. Our good mate Gotti, Gotham Dingra, second in the party high roller for $26,000 on Monday morning. Our previous guest, Liam Moffo, 47 Moffat, second in the big 162 for 17,000 last week, continues his really, really hot run of form at the moment and all year, basically. He's up in a heap, I would imagine. And he also managed to final table the Supersonic on Monday morning as well.
I when I heard he final tabled it, it's actually funny because I heard it through Gotti, who was the other name you mentioned. I couldn't believe it. I've never ever thought the Supersonic is one of those tournaments where it's like, I wonder how long it'll last this time. I'm going to try and beat 5 minutes.
And why did you use that tone when you said Gotti?
Gotti. Because Gotham's a friend of mine, and he's like, it's hard to explain to those people that don't know Gotham. I just suggest introducing yourself and actually getting to know him, because he's quite an interesting human being, quite an interesting specimen. No, Gotti's actually been he has a different kind of play, and he has been crushing lately. And I do get to talk to him a bit about theory when he decides to let his guard down, and it's great to hear him. He's also been quite a help to Fadzy, who's obviously been having a lot of success lately. Climbing the
LB rankings. Fadzy too.
Oh, I'm not too sure about that. But
He mentioned it to me the other day, but yeah.
Oh, what a boss.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's rapidly climbing up the Pocket Fives rankings.
All I'm hoping is for Fadzy to like bink off a scoop just to tilt Gotti. That's all I want. That's what I said to Fadzy when I was talking to him. I'm like, okay, so like, or now all you need to do is just win a scoop just to tell them.
There's all those Gotti stories, because you know, people buy action off each other and they do swaps. And Gotti's the kind of person where someone will offer him action and say it'll be to a live event, and you know, people charge markup and stuff, and live events are really soft, so you could charge probably like a markup 1.3. And there have been times where I offered Gotti action in something, I can't remember, and I was like, oh, give us 1.3, and he's like, oh, 1.2, because he's a real businessman. He always likes to, you know, try and get a good bargain.
Is that bit of the Indian coming out in him?
I shouldn't say that,
because he's American.
But, and like, when he turns down action, he'll actively root against you, because he doesn't want to have missed an opportunity. So he's one of those. It's real interesting. I've never seen anything like it before.
Hold up, Chu. This is an Australian program. Why are we using the word root? In a sexual context.
I use that. I'm sorry. Is that an Australian?
Well, it's American.
Is it?
Oh, have you ever heard an Australian speak about going for someone or cheering for someone or barracking for someone and saying, I'm rooting for them? No.
I just said it.
You. That's it. Only, like, you're American.
That's us.
You're
a fake.
You're a phony.
Okay, mate.
Zach might have to sack you from Convict Corner, because you may as well go and join, like, Poker Air. Air. However the hell they want to say it. See, I'm not Canadian.
That's Canadian. It's Poker Air.
I'm not Canadian, so I can't even say it.
Oh, God. All right. Keep digging a hole, Matt.
All right. Tollgate, Tom Grigg, Hunter Rick.
Your mate, Tolga?
12.5K. Well done to Tom. And also fourth in the 50 rebuy Monday morning for another close to 10K, 9.5K. So, sorry, I'm going to whip through this really quickly so we can get Sean on. James Bills, 14th, 2K, 6 max scoop. Great effort. He's an
Adelaide boy. Bang. Just got to rep Adelaide for those who don't know. It is a city.
14K. A very honourable mention. We always go for the one honourable mention every week, and that was Ben Richardson, our good friend, 2018. Final tabling the iPops, 50 rebuy turbo, finishing a very respectable 7th place in that.
Poor guy. I just remember him crying so much. Oh, it's not fair every time.
He's going to be so big final tables. To be
he's, fair. Final he's going to be so final annoyed. I'm so annoyed that you brought it up and said seventh.
Final table, the 100 turbo today, the big 100 turbo on stars.
Oh, God. It's
close to 20K up top, goes in one of nine, gets in top set on like ace, XX, all clubs against a naked queen of clubs for three times the pot. Someone just shoves three times the pot. Benny gets it in with top set. And old mate just like snaps off a club on the river and poor Benny goes out ninth. So,
oh, Benny.
He's not running good on final tables, but we still love him.
Well, I'd love to get him on the show, but you know, he's very shy. He's not a bit, he's not a wordsmith like you or I. He's quite a shy man. But I do want to introduce some kind of Benny Bunny related segment to our show. I think that needs to replace the Ask Chew. We have to have something like,
yeah, Ask Chew is definitely canned after last week.
Benny Bunny 18's quote of the week. Next week, we'll try and get that up.
All right. Okay, so into live poker. Oh, sorry. The last thing there was currently with 148 players left in the 1K scoop, plenty of big names in the Australian poker scene remaining in that tournament. Liam, Moneyshot O'Rourke, Jono Karamalikas, Gotham Dingra, Chris Kunz, and also Kiwi King Pauly, all still in the hunt in that event and all have decent stacks. So good luck to those guys tomorrow.
It's a great tournament to rail as well, guys. So for the Australian people that don't play as often, get on the rail and chuck out your support for them.
Into live poker, ANZPT Perth wrapped up. Managed to get a field of 310 players. We were talking about them getting just under 200 last week. They ended up getting 310. Eventually, it was Matt Carlson who ended up taking all of the cookies home for $78,000. Congratulations to him. The Joe Hashem Deep Stack kicked off Melbourne Poker Champs, and it was Ramald Parsons who took it down for $50,000. Highly notable is Jackie Glazier, who came second for $35,000. I think she was a former Full Tilt representative.
Yep, I think she was a red pro, or she might have been. No, I think she was a red pro.
Yeah,
She's been doing really well in the live scene, which is not to say surprising, but you know, it's rare that you see someone like who's not a young up and comer just like crush the live scene. Especially like a female, you just don't see that kind of thing. The only kind of female crusher we've got going these days is, I guess, Annette, and she is totally like a young internet superstar. Vanessa, so to see Kells. Her doing, oh well, she is an internet superstar as well to some degree.
Well, yeah.
Well, I mean, like you know what I mean, but her like she's got a lot of live experience. But no, Jackie seems to be just getting a lot of work done in the live scene. It's very, yeah, it's very good to see a nice Australian girl getting it done.
I agree.
You could be the next Australian girl, Matt.
Well, that's not going to happen. So she's clearly good at poker, and I'm clearly not. But
yeah.
Event two of the Melbourne Championships was won by Ryan Peters for $20,000, $170 freeze out, 20K score, very nicely done. Just on that note as well, Poker Asia Pacific are actually doing live reporting on the Melbourne Poker Championships. So if anyone's interested in following that, it's www.pokerasiapacific.com. They've got a forum up there. I think it's really cool that they've got a forum there and a community that Australians can kind of get involved in now. So I really like that about this, that they've done that with the site. And they're also doing the live reporting of the Melbourne Championships if anybody's interested in following that as it's going on. Lastly, there was the announcement of the Sydney Championships this week for August 1st to 12th. 10 events on the schedule, 1.6K main event. This same event last year had a field of 315 runners for a really nice prize pool. So we'll probably discuss this as it kind of gets closer to the date, but it was announced during the week. So that's our weekly wrap-up of what is happening around Australia, both live and online. And we are going to take a very short break, and we're going to come back with our guest tonight, our editor and editor-in-chief and director of Poker Media Australia, Sean Callender, and we'll be back right after this short break. All right, guys, we're back. Sorry about the long delay. I had some problems with my Skype. So we're going to be joined in a couple of seconds by Our guest tonight, Sean Callender, he's the current director and editor-in-chief at pokermedia.com. How are you, Sean?
Gentlemen, lovely to be with you.
Lovely to have you.
How are you,
Sean? Thank you very much. Yeah, very good, thanks. Pretty yucky night down here in Melbourne. A couple of thunderstorms going through, but all good. What about yourselves?
That's what you get down in AFL territory. We've got it nice up here in sunny New South Wales.
I don't know if you're familiar with this kind of rivalry, because anyone.
Well, he has an AFL background, I believe, don't you, Sean?
I do, actually. Yeah, spent a number of years working at the AFL, so yeah, very keen follower of the footy down here. But no, I love all sports, boys. So of course, state of origin looks like the new home might be Melbourne. So you mightn't be left with much at all.
Oh please, I don't like Melbourne sucking all the money out of our game, but no, it can be good for the game if used correctly. Anyway, you're right, Chu?
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, mate.
Far away.
You good? All right, mate. Just for our listeners and even ourselves, I guess, who aren't as familiar with you as like you're very well known within the Australian poker community. Can you just like enlighten some people who don't know a lot about you about your how you got involved in the poker industry and a little on your background within the industry as well?
Yeah, sure. Well, my background's in journalism. I've been a journalist for 25 years, most of that time in the sporting world. So worked in London for a decade with the Daily Mail Group, and did a lot of work there in soccer, boxing, cycling, athletics, all sorts of sports. Came back to Australia, worked for the Fairfax Group for quite a while. Then moved on to the World Surfing Tour, and then finally with the AFL, where I worked on the AFL publishing side of things and the licensing side of things. And while I was working there, it was, I suppose, like a lot of people would, when they've been in the same industry for a while, sort of thought about going out on my own. And it was really about just finding the right opportunity. And this is sort of going back to about 2005, which everyone will know is the time that that Joe Hashem won the World Series. But really, poker had been on my radar for a little while. It was an emerging industry and a new media industry as well. So I thought it was a good opportunity to get in at the bottom end. And so started Monarch Media with Stephen Doig, my business partner, in 2006. And that's really how we got into it. It was we saw it as a good opportunity for a startup business to get into a publishing space. It was niche enough that we could make a living out of it, but not big enough that we were going to get swamped by a big operator. And look, it's been a fantastic ride for us. We've really loved it, and yeah, a very dynamic and exciting industry to be involved in.
Okay, that's quite the background. I didn't realize that you had such a sporting background. I'm a huge sporting lover, and so is Chewy, actually. So, I mean, it's really cool to hear that you come from that kind of background and saw the opportunity in poker. You were the editor of Bluff Australasia, is that correct?
Yeah, correct. What we did when we first started was, really there was Poker Network and nothing else in terms of content. So we thought we were going to struggle initially, so we spoke to Eric Morrison, the guys at Bluff in the States, and basically applied for a license and received it. So we ran Bluff from 06 through to 09, and then merged that magazine into the new, what was then new at the time, the Poker News magazine, which folded up in the middle of last year. So we're actually on our third title in the poker world. We've just started a new magazine called The Real Deal, which initially the first couple of issues just were digital, but we've just started to print that magazine again. So it's been a bit of a rocky ride in terms of starting from scratch, but it's just the way that things have panned out for us.
Yeah, if I could just jump in, Matt. If someone wanted to get a hold of this magazine, how would they be able to do that?
Well, you can log straight through our site, pokermedia.com.au. So the digital version of the magazine's there. We initially did a print run for the ANZPT in Sydney. Star City had requested it. So, look, it was just a few hundred magazines, and we weren't originally expecting to print this magazine probably until the end of the year, but the demand's obviously there that people want to get their hands on it. So unfortunately, the revenue's not there at the moment, but look, it's steadily crawling back, and as with each issue, we're hoping to print more and more and get it back into the poker rooms and through the poker leagues, and then eventually, hopefully, back into the news agents around the country.
Yeah, definitely. Yes. When I was first starting off, before I actually found poker, I used to work part-time at a casino while I was doing uni. And one thing I used to do in my break is always read the Poker News magazine. And I used to love reading about the articles and reading the online report and reading about names like Monster Dong and Delaney, who was really, I always found it very awkward when they used to report his name, CNT Crusher. Which I was like, what an unfortunate name that boy picked. But
coming from a background of having to watch out for those type of typos and things in stories, to have that name continually flashing up in front of you when you're doing an online report, it's very unnerving.
I can only imagine. But Sean, like, I think that's really awesome though, that because coming from someone who has actually read both issues of your magazine in the digital version, that is. One of the things that I really like is, I don't know if it's traditionalism or whatever, is I like actually having the magazine and actually being able to like flick through the pages. Like, I know it might sound silly, but reading a digital magazine, like, it's cool and stuff and your content's good, but like, it was always like the couple of times that I read it, I was just like, it's not the same. Like, it's harder to kind of sit there and read through it online and sit in front of a computer, and it might have something to do with the fact that I spend so much time in front of a computer anyway, but I like that actually having the paper magazine in front of you and being able to flick through and read it, if that makes any sense.
Well, look, boys, and I think that's one of the issues for the publishing industry as a whole. You know, we work, we do books, we do magazines. My background's in newspapers, and that lifestyle aspect of wanting to have that concrete product in your hands is something that I think will ensure that those products survive for a long time. It's great. Members of my family, have all got their Kindles. They're big book readers, but for myself, I don't get to read a book very often, and to be able to sit down and actually have that book in front of you is, as I said, a lifestyle thing.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
When you see everyone in the poker room reading the magazine and flipping through it, it's much better, especially when we used to do, I used to make a Melbourne trip when I was first starting out, and I used to pinch a couple of magazines and take them home with me, read them on the flight. It was really good. And I know that Maddie would love to put his hand up to be on the cover, because then when next Aussie Millions rolls around, he's actually got something physical to sign when the fans come up. So that'd be very good for him.
Yes, maybe. Well, we are working on a Men of Poker calendar, so we might be able to get him in.
No, you definitely need Chew for that one.
anyway, Mr. March or Mr. April?
I'll let you choose. I'll just go January and just get out of the way. It'll just be like a close-up face shot.
Don't give Chew any input on this, because he'll want to be Mr. January, February, March, April, May, June.
So, we might have to settle for a centerfold to start with.
Mate, so it is clear though that you have, like, since 2006, you've been involved in Australian poker media, and I guess what you said there was you essentially got in at the ground level. I dare say we're one of the first people that was really involved in the poker media here in Australia. How do you think that it's changed in recent times? Like, you've had to go through these transitional periods as you've gone from like Bluff to Poker News and now into poker media. How do you think that the industry's changed? Because, like, I guess we hear that the impact of like Black Friday, just as an example, had on the games and on the players, and it's quite often forgotten that the media outlets that are associated with poker. And so I guess, how did it affect you and your industry being in the poker media?
It decimated it, and it's a really interesting case, because the poker industry in the modern era, say from 2003 to 2005, it took off so quickly that there wasn't really any media before that. There was a Card Player magazine and Poker Player in the States, and this even you know, predated poker news to some extent. And all of a sudden you had a lot of money in the industry. It was very easy, particularly in the States, to start up new magazines. And I remember going over to the 06 World Series, and at that time there was probably about 14 or 15 different poker magazines. And so it was easy to do. But then now with the essentially from a US perspective and certainly a local perspective, that online money is dried up. So your business case is completely different. And that was really the reason why we decided to take a step back from the agreement that we have with Poker News and really start from scratch. The downside is that it's hurt us financially, you know, quite dramatically. The upside is that we've got something now that's sustainable. And so we had to take that decision to, you know, were we going to stay in the industry or not? And we decided that we would. And so now, you know, we're really in it for the long haul. It's certainly not putting a lot of money in our bank accounts at the moment, but you know, that'll come. It's you know, we're working towards resolutions on a number of fronts, and you know, trying to find some new products and some new initiatives to launch. And so, yeah, but to answer your question, you know, poker media globally has really been hit very hard. Yeah. And you can see that by the number of TV shows that the, you know, Poker After Dark, the big game shows and such that, you know, have really, you know, now longer don't exist at all. And so it's been a big hit to the poker media.
Mm. Yeah, that's the one thing that there's a difference when it comes to poker media, when the dollars seem to have dried up, but the love for the game from the public point of view is as strong as ever. If you go to like any kind of poker pub, I know in Adelaide, they just get massive numbers out. So there's a lot of fans there. And there's a lot of people willing to, you know, read the magazines and read the internet articles. But with the market being so dominated by one player as it is that what's holding you back from getting a kind of you know, the dollars coming in to support your product?
Look, it really, the big problem we have with poker, well, look, I won't say it's a problem, it's just the way it is that when we talk about poker, we're talking about, you know, four fairly distinct segments of the industry. You've got, obviously, casinos, you've got online poker, you've got home games, and you've got pub poker. Now, to actually monetize those players is very difficult because they're all playing the game for very, very different reasons. Casinos want to see players coming into their rooms so they can be playing cash games and then go and play the other games in their properties. Pub is, you know, completely different mentality. They want people coming in, spending money on drinks and food and whatever else. And so where it's difficult for us is we've got a fairly good, you know, we know our demographic really well, but the argument from a mainstream point of view is that they're already reaching those people in other ways. And so the challenge for us, and it's something we're working through at the moment, is to really get poker pushed into the mainstream as much as we can. And just so people can see that there's this, you know, groundswell of people, of you know, hundreds of thousands who love the game in Australia, and hopefully get some mainstream industries and businesses involved in it. And then for us, you know, to piggyback onto that in terms of advertising and support, but it's in some ways it's something we probably should have done earlier. But having the bank of online money and just to some extent the casino money as well, it made it reasonably easy for us. Whereas now it's a fresh challenge, but yeah, that's a challenge, and I think everyone's going to benefit from that in the long run.
Well, hopefully,
absolutely.
And look, having the World Series in Australia is, I think that'll be probably the first step back onto that ladder. I think we're going to get a real good shot of mainstream coverage through the World Series being here, and I think it'll be a, you know, second little push along for everyone to, you know, to bring poker back into the spotlight. And I think we've all got to work together and, you know, to just sort of put our hands up and say, you know, there's this community of people here that are, you know, quite large in number and love this game, and that they're the kind of things that are going to help us out in the long run.
Absolutely. And like, I guess even pre Black Friday, like, you saw sponsorship from Stars and Full Tilt both on NRL teams even at that point in time. In terms of getting it mainstream and getting it in the public eye, that was something that, you know, like, that you, the fact that you brought that up and it made me think about it, you know, that instantly disappeared this year naturally. and that was something that, you know, even if it was like small, short arm patches or whatever, the fact that it was kind of seeping into like professional sports as an advertising option, I kind of showed that it was getting into the mainstream a little bit more, and we kind of took a huge step backwards, I guess, is what you were saying there.
Yeah, and look, I think, you know, using the rugby league clubs as an example, that, you know, I walk into the Crown Poker Room, you see, you know, AFL guys in there all the time. I know from having been up at the Star for the last couple of series that you've got, you know, big names in rugby and league and boxing and all these guys playing poker. And I think it's, you know, they're going to provide us with a good opportunity to get that mainstream coverage and, you know, talk to these guys, you know, why are they playing poker? What do they get out of it? And you know, harness their popularity and the coverage that they get to help us out as well.
Yeah, well, Trip Later on a good wicket with Warnie over there. So,
oh, that was a very nice pun.
The pun.
Yeah, very nice.
Mate, now, well, I mean, one of the things that I was kind of excited about having you on was a couple of the, I guess here we on Convict Corner, we don't mind clowning around a little bit at times, but I guess someone that has so much experience and depth of knowledge in the industry, I saw it as a good opportunity to nut down some more serious questions. So if you don't mind me asking, like, how do you feel personally that the economy sits right now in Australia poker-wise? Like, I don't even mean necessarily comparatively. I just mean, how do you see it going forward at the moment, the actual poker industry?
I think it's consolidated. Look, one of the things it's really hard to gauge is that 95% of people who play poker in Australia play in pubs and clubs. So actually monetizing what their value to the industry is quite difficult. And the other side of it is, you know, with the online sites is, you know, aside from the odd university study, and I know that there was an IBIS World report came out in the last few weeks about the actual size of the online industry in Australia. Again, you're not getting, you know, great figures to compare, you know, what was going on 2 or 3 years ago to now. But look, I would say that the online economy's is pretty healthy. It's probably dropped off a little bit in the last 12 months purely on the basis that you've had Full Tilt out of the market and the fact that the more obvious marketing channels, be it our magazines and some of the websites and such, haven't been taking those ads and promoting those events as much. But look, I think overall it's pretty healthy. The casinos, in particular Crown, have clearly taken a decision that they're edging away from the smaller buy-in series like the Joe Hashem Deep Stack series and sort of aiming at the next step up. But I don't think that's necessarily a problem. That someone will fill that gap to simply. Yep. So, you know, whether it's, you know, we've seen in Adelaide and Perth and Canberra coming up that now those $1,100 buy-in events are coming in. So across the board, I think the economy's pretty healthy. I think the pub market's consolidated. You know, from a height of probably 400,000 people going back 4 or 5 years to today, where you're probably looking at around about maybe 100, 120,000 who play every month, they're still good numbers. And some of those people are playing, you know, many times a week. So overall, I think we're in pretty good shape. But again, coming back to that World Series event, I think that's going to be the sort of second wave of momentum for us. A lot of people are going to come back to poker. We're going to get some new people involved. And if we can get this online puzzle sorted, then I think going forward we're in really good shape.
See that? Well, like, that does... Sorry, go on, Matt.
Well, to close that out, because I was kind of going to segue into a further question.
As you do, I was going to say that does seem like the final piece in the puzzle when it comes to the Australian scene. I think that the World Series Australia or Asia Pacific, as they're calling it, is really going to like revitalize the Australian economy, bring in new people, as you say. I was a bit concerned about the lack of big buy-in tournaments that we had going around. I know that some of the tours were dropped to 1K buy-ins, and that's not the best sign as like a flagship event. But given that we now will have our second big tour and all the media attention that comes with it, that's going to totally rejuvenize not only the poker community but also poker media. Speaking of poker media, though, if you don't mind, Matt, I've got a question for you, because I know that this is your area of expertise. You can give insight. If you wind the clock back 12 months, 18 months, there was a saga going on involving mainstream media. I know that you're a poker commentator, so you're more on our side. But I know that the papers like to call out poker players as a bit of a shady/immoral kind of practice at times. There was an article about, I think it was Chris Kunz calling him out on earning millions of dollars, which is not true, and not paying tax on it. There was an article set up with Jono, where I think it was a promotional article, which the person then turned into like an article on tax. How do you feel the mainstream media feels about the Australian poker industry?
I would say that they just don't understand it. And again, coming back to the point of having a united front, because our industry is so segmented that there is no unifying voice speaking on behalf of poker. So from a PR perspective, it's very difficult. One of the things that I would love to do at some point is to get some key stakeholders in the industry, casino online, pub poker, some pros, some amateur players, get a group of mainstream media in front of them and actually explain how this industry works. Because if you come, you know, and I don't blame the journalists in question, because if you look at the law in black and white, and then talk to these guys, you know, they're playing on sites that don't operate in this country legally, that the guys don't pay tax. And when they come into these situations, and particularly with Jono, I did feel sorry for, he doesn't know the kind of questions that he's going to be asked, and he also doesn't know how he's going to be portrayed and how other online pros are going to be portrayed as a result of those answers. So, again, it's just, you know, a lot of our key people slip through the cracks and they don't get the right PR advice. They're not properly counselled in terms of their own image and such. And so when you lump all that together, it is easy to kind of think of poker players as, you know, bums or, you know young smartasses earning millions of dollars. But, you know, I think, look, there's a fair bit of impetus around at the moment for us to get some form of industry group up and going. And I think that's going to be a huge help to, you know, for, you know, guys, hopefully we'll be able to assist in finding sponsorship opportunities. And then, you know, once you get sponsors on board, you do have levels of responsibility or explain in Chris's case that, yeah, you might have, you know, earned all this money, but, you know, to explain the difference that, you know, he's obviously spent plenty of money in buy-ins and whatever else. And so while he might have won a certain amount, it's balanced out. And the mainstream media just don't understand these things. So it's a double-edged sword to some extent.
Do you think that? I've got to follow one more follow-up question, Matt.
You guys need a bell.
Matt is chomping at the bit because he's got all his questions and they're all like organized. And I'm just hoping that one of my questions like asks one of his questions, so he, like, there's a little hole in his line of questioning and he'll be angry. Do you think that there's like a way that like people like Matthew and myself, actual poker players, would be able to get mainstream coverage or do articles with the media again? Because there is this unwritten law amongst the poker community just not to talk to any kind of non-poker media, like any kind of newspaper.
Well, I'd throw the question back to you guys. Why? You know, it's just a matter of, you know, treating yourself like, if you want to be professionals in this field, think of yourselves as sports people, or think of yourself as business people. And you know, I've had this conversation with many poker players over the past few years. And if you want to go out and source yourself mainstream sponsorship, I'd say absolutely go for it. But do it properly. You've got to think of yourself, you know, what am I offering a business? One of the problems I see with a lot of poker players is that they think, oh, it's just sponsorship is about sticking a patch on and sitting in a tournament and that's about it. But, you know, in the real world, it's about, you know, what value are you going to bring a sponsor, an advertiser and such. And so I think that there's a massive opportunity because no one's really been able to harness that opportunity. Of course, you know, Joe Hashem with his associations with Crown is a good example. But only in the last couple of days, Joe put up a blog about professionalism in the game, and just little things like turning up at a final table, not in a, you know, with your ass hanging out of a pair of shorts and a ripped t-shirt and not having washed in 3 or 4 days. They're all little things, but you'd be surprised how quickly they can add up. And so if you want to have a shot at getting some sort of professional profile, I think the opportunity is there because no one's really seriously gone after it.
Yeah, see, Chu actually led me kind of to the question that I was going to ask you there was, with that incident that happened in the mainstream media, well, those multiple incidents that happened in the mainstream media, and I believe that Steve Leonard also had one around that time.
There were a few that are just calling out players. So it was, and it was a few different papers, and it seemed to get all at the one time a few different articles popping up, and it kind of sent like some kind of conspiracy against us.
Well, it's kind of restrictive on players to not speak now to mainstream media because those players felt like a lot of what was said was twisted. And you bring up some perfectly valid points that, you know, they didn't get the right PR advice. They didn't know, you know, how their words could be used or what the questions that were going to be asked or, you know, how they were going to be used in the article. But, I mean, I don't think that they're, you know, I think that when there's innocent intentions taken from the side of the person and call it naive, it probably is a little bit, and they're turned around in a very negative light across the whole industry, and those players were getting a lot of various negative feedbacks from other people within the industry. It certainly makes poker players in general hesitant, if not, you know, just completely restricted to speak to mainstream media at all. And do you think that's restrictive on poker going forward, that people aren't now willing to speak to mainstream media at all?
Well, it is for the players, depending on what they want to get out of it.
Okay.
You know, if I just said, you know, someone randomly ring up and speak wanted to speak to me about something, the first thing I'd do is I'd say, what do you want to know, and arrange a time for them to call back. You know, no different to this interview is, you know, you don't want to be caught unawares in terms of the content that you're expected to cover, and I think that would give an opportunity to, you know, say someone from your local paper rings either of you guys, and you know, what is the purpose of the journalist ringing you? What do they want to get out of it? And you can quiz them on what they want to get out of it. And if you feel it's going to be a hatchet job, then just say, look, I don't want to be involved. But there's a flip side to all of that, and that's using the mainstream media for your benefits. And if you're properly prepared in terms of establishing what messages you want to get across, and when they ask the tricky question about, you know, tax and playing online and all those kind of things, that you've got a prepared response and you can reason it through, then on that basis, I think it's a massively untapped resource for all poker players.
That's interesting because we have the Newcastle Herald here, and during Aussie Millions, I actually got asked to speak to one of the journalists for the Newcastle Herald, and I didn't even bother. And I guess part of it is exactly what you're saying, is that I wasn't willing to be prepared either. And also just that there was that, you know, this black mark laying over mainstream media and the way that they portray or have portrayed. And like, as you said, I there's no fault of theirs. They have a job to do and they're trying to put a certain message and story out there. And I guess it is the responsibility of the player to make sure that, what they give is what they want to give. But I mean, I think that we're all a little more knowledgeable about it now, and I guess that makes a lot of people hesitant. But
yeah, and you know, a lot of the guys that are involved in these stories, you know, they're young guys, and you know, you get a phone call from the newspaper wanting to talk to you about what you're doing that, and you know, the first reaction is going to be, oh yeah, this is great, you know, being a bit starstruck, I suppose you'd say, and without thinking of the consequences. But look, for anyone listening, I just say, don't think of the mainstream media as an enemy. It's just about preparing properly if you do want to be involved in a story. But from the flip side of it, that for anyone wanting to get a profile established, I think there's a huge opportunity for across the board for players to get out there and talk about what they do, and maybe that would lead to some sponsorship and advertising to come with it.
Okay. Now, I guess moving on just a little bit, I guess what we can establish from all of this that you clearly have your finger on the pulse on pretty much all things poker, and I guess you need to as the editor-in-chief of Poker Media. Politically, I mean, there's been a lot said politically, and that was around that time as well. How do you feel online poker in Australia is currently viewed politically, and do you think there's any chance of anything happening on that front?
Yeah, okay.
I know it's a very broad question. I mean, you can go wherever you want with this.
Yeah. Look, we were fortunate enough to be involved with the Productivity Commission hearings going back 2 years now, and then also with the Senate inquiries last year. The two key issues at a departmental level, I think the government certainly understands where the industry's at. And I was actually pleasantly surprised at their knowledge, that they had a pretty good feel for what the want was in the gaming industry, and had advised both the Productivity Commission and the Senate inquiries wisely. And I think the outcomes of both of those inquiries were really positive, that essentially the IGA was nominated as a piece of vastly outdated legislation that was being applied to modern situations for which it wasn't prepared. When you get into the political sphere of things is where it gets very complicated, because for us to go in as an industry best case scenario and put forward our case of why online poker and online gaming should be licensed and available to Australian customers legally, the first thing that any politician is going to say, is this going to get me a vote? And in most cases, the answer to that's going to be no. Yeah. We were reasonably hopeful that a change of government imminent when it happens would be a positive thing. But even then, you've got to go back and look that the coalition were responsible for bringing the IGA in the first place. And yeah. Tony Abbott certainly made some noises that he's not about to go through and tear the IGA up and pull it back together. So, look, we'll keep working. That's all we can really do. I think that the case we have, and particularly I think the greatest example is what happened with Full Tilt. And it makes me sick to the stomach to think that Australian residents who played on that site and lost money, and you being Absolute and the other sites that this has happened to, aren't protected. That there was nothing under Australian law that they could do. And I think that at the very basis that it's got, I think the status quo can't be maintained in the long term, that it's really got to go one way or the other, purely on the basis that Australian residents who want to play online poker should be protected by our laws. So from an industry point of view, we want to say, yep, get in there. Yes, we need to legislate this properly, but get the industry involved so we can put forward, you know, what the best case scenario is going forward to make sure that the players aren't disenfranchised. You know, if you put a great big tax on it, obviously that's going to flow through into the games and make them prohibitive. People aren't going to want to play. So it's got to balance out for all the key stakeholders. Is it going to change? I honestly couldn't answer it, guys. I hope, and you know, we'll certainly do everything we can, but it's going to be a question for politicians rather than government departments to make the final call.
Very interesting. It's such a gray area, isn't it? It has been for such a long time. To us it is anyway.
I think that's one of the simplest things is that it's not great. You know, if you want to have a read through the half a dozen paragraphs in the Act that are relevant, you know, it's clearly illegal for the offshore sites to offer their services to Australian customers. Now, the problem is that at some point there was a decision taken either in the department or with the federal police that they either couldn't or they wouldn't prosecute. So you're left with this really, and that's the grey area, because you know there's plenty of people out there breaking the law, but you know, can you prosecute them? Is it worth prosecuting them? Is it a do they view it as a victimless crime and that they're happy to keep continued? But I think for the industry's point of view, and again, I come back to the players having to be at the forefront of this, that, you know, heaven forbid, you know, the same thing that happened with Full Tilt happened with PokerStars, and all of a sudden there was, you know, and that would decimate the economy. Now, of course, we know that that's highly unlikely that that would occur, but the building blocks of that happening still exist. It hasn't been addressed. And so I think from the point of view of protecting ourselves, that's really the case that we should be putting forward and saying that, look, our people deserve protection.
Yeah.
The main issue with that is just going to be protection at what cost, because every government that wants to regulate will instinctively want to take a piece of the pie, especially given how tight most economies are at the moment. And that's going to be a massive... for example, if the US becomes regulated and they don't make an exorbitant tax on it, the poker economy should, like you'd think, come back to the times of 2007 where, you know, people were making some really good money. But if every country does decide to get their finger in the pie and, like, take it out, it's gonna pretty much kill a lot of the online action.
Yeah, but think of it beyond that regulated would mean that all of a sudden we're going to have poker on Australian television. We're going to have poker in the mainstream. We're going to have, you know, it's going to be, the mainstream media will get on board poker very quickly once they can start taking ads. So commercially, it would be a massive step up. So yes, the online action might decline, but it's going to open up 1,000 other doors. And that's, I think, the real positive aspect of legislation and licensing that's forgotten in the discussions.
It's a very good point.
Sorry, I've lost my train of thought completely. Sorry, I've been up since very early this morning playing Scoops. So I did have another question that I was going to throw in there and another point along those lines, but I've completely lost it.
I've got a question if I can jump in, Matt.
Yeah, now, mate, I know keep that, going.
Seeing that you do come from a sporting background, and I know that you're going to have some kind of input on this, the age-old question, is poker a sport? Well, can it be regarded as a sport? When we speak to the media, will they report us as quasi-athletes?
That's another really tricky one for the mainstream media, is that, you know, the way programming and newspapers and magazines work, it's about categories. Where does poker sit? A crown with the Aussie Millions have always sold the entertainment and the glitz and glamour and that side of it. But, you know, in other parts of the world, ESPN, probably the best example, it's considered a sport. So there's pluses and minuses. I think it's very difficult in the Australian media to convince people that something that's existed for quite a while all of a sudden becomes a sport. All we can really do, again, that comes back to sitting down with the operators and say, look, we want to find a space here. You know, where at this point, I wouldn't really care where it's at, providing it got some coverage. You know, I get the Sunday paper and I'm still reading the bloody chess columns and bridge columns, and I think, well, geez, you reckon that you could just eke out a little bit of space for some poker content in there. But, look, from a media point of view, I don't think it really matters. It's just once we get our toe in the door, the media will decide where it sits. It's just really about finding the right space. Sport's probably the perfect one, but if it was somewhere else, it wouldn't matter.
Yeah, agreed. I don't think poker's a sport because you get to sit on your ass for so long. But anyway.
Fine sporting sports in any poker room, though.
Let's move on to, I guess, the place where we do typically sit on our asses for a long time, the live poker scene, because we've talked so much about the online economy and the online politically and all that kind of business. One of the questions I wanted to ask you was why, like, you know, Stars obviously now has a huge market share and a larger dominance, and they do have all of these tours all over the world. And, you know, one that's been predominant here in Australia has been the ANZBT. This year, though, they've kind of scaled it down and placed a lot less emphasis on that ANZBT. The APPT, they've actually added stops and is going strong. But the ANZBT, which is, you know, the our real local tour, much like the LAPT or was, or like the UK IPT. Yeah, and the NAPT. Why do you think that Stars has placed less emphasis on the ANZBT this year?
Look, speaking to the marketing guys at Stars at the start of the year, that they took a decision that they wanted to let go of some of the what they perceived as the smaller events and just focus on the bigger ones. They're in a really awkward position because they've got a marketing team located in Sydney, but they don't really have any spaces in which to market. You know, they can't place ads anywhere. There's limited opportunities even in place of getting content out. So there, it's become a tougher job for them to sell those tours. And the flip side of that is that there's so many Stars events on at any one time. So you get on there and you see the list of satellites, and there can be, you know, up to a dozen events at the one time. And so I think you can start to bastardize each other's tours to some extent. But having said that, I was a bit surprised that, you know, they then came up with this sort of 50-50 compromise of having points events in some venues, and then they were going to have a Gold Coast event that couldn't go ahead because the poker room's undergoing some renovations at the moment. So Perth became a tour event. Now Canberra's going to be a points event. So in short, I can't answer it. I'm not sure why they've changed that strategy. It makes perfect sense for them to maintain the rage in Asia because that's where the growth is going to come from. Yeah. But at this point where, you know, now the WSOP coming in is going to maybe complicate it a little bit more in terms of where the dollars are going to go next year. So, it's a difficult one for them. And again, it just comes down to they've got to be pretty careful about putting themselves out there too much because there's clearly more attention from a legal perspective on what they're doing. Which was one of the key reasons we, you know, had to change our operations as well. It, you know, it became fairly clear to us that the Federal Police and the Crime Commission were looking at the industry. And so, you know, I think they've probably had to take a step back from what they're able to do in the past. So, you know, how that's going to manifest going forward, will the ANZPT remain? Probably. I don't think it'll ever get back to the point of being seven or eight events in a year, but if it can sit in that space of the say $2,000-$2,200 buy-in events, I think there's a real demand for those, and if that's how it ends up being, I don't think that's such a bad result.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I'm happy if they stay at like $2,000-$2,500 buy-ins. I mean, can you see though? I can definitely see that perspective, but can you also see how it's somewhat of a bad reflection on Stars and a real, excuse me for putting it bluntly, like a real pain in the ass for a lot of us that we can't really travel that much because, you know, being so far, and I'm sure you understand that traveling to Europe is a good hefty flight, 20 hours. Even into Asia, you know, you have to jump on a plane for 7 to 8 hours. It's expensive. You know, I think that because we are so isolated from the rest of the world, that it's very important that we do keep our tour down here and we do keep it in good order. But it comes across to us like Stars really don't care about poker down here in Australia. The fact that they went this way about it, I guess, to a certain degree.
Look, you've got to put it from their point of view.
Yeah.
I understand where you're coming from, but at the same time, there are two purposes. Is to, one, get people playing on their site, and two, getting their name and their brand out there via the association with these tours. Now, half of that has been removed for the local operation. So the scenario of having an online site running a poker tour from a business sense isn't really the best way of doing it. And I think if you have a look at the WPT as a generic model, is that the tour is the core product. And it works really well on that basis because you can take a sit back and say, okay, what are the different economies able to support? And they've still got their premier tour, but they've started now with these national series and a lot of smaller buy-in events, particularly in the States because there's such a demand for it at the moment.
Yeah.
And that's where they've got that flexibility that they're able to do it, where PokerStars are always going to be coming back to the core, and that's going to be getting bums on seats in front of their sites playing satellites. So it works for the casinos to some extent because obviously they're getting the qualifiers through and generating the revenue from their perspective. But it's not the best model of doing a poker tour. And look, boys, to be honest, I wouldn't be surprised if someone else put their hand up at some point and said that there's a better way of doing this and took them on, because it's just so difficult for them now that being denied that sort of marketing and promotional edge to their brands that they've had in the past, it makes it increasingly tougher for them.
Mm.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that you say that, Matt, before about PokerStars not giving Australia any love. I think Matt is slightly bitter because he did get rejected with his sponsorship deal. But being the big PokerStars fanboy that I am, I was very surprised to see them releasing a lot of their pros, people like Tony Hashem, who had a lot of success on the World Series, didn't find a contract coming his way. Do you think that there's any room, given the expansion of the World Series into Australia, of them signing more tournament pros?
Zero.
Zero?
And the reason is, and look, I must admit, I followed the commentary on numerous sites about the online pro position. And look, from an outsider looking in, it was completely half-assed to me from a number of points. But purely on the basis of, okay, you're an online pro, you get something out of it. But if I was running PokerStars, I'd be questioning what I actually get out of the sponsorship. And I think that's what they've had to look at is, okay, we really can't, there's nowhere for us to promote our name and promote any players that we get on board. So why are we paying them? And I think that was the decision that really came with, it was probably a bit easier to start with guys like Eric and Emad. And I know, Eric was sort of looking to get out of it to some extent anyway. But Tony was a tricky one because, he's got a very good profile in poker, but he's also got quite a good profile in mainstream media, particularly in Melbourne. He's out and about, and he does have a good profile, and a lot of people know him. So it comes back to a marketing decision for PokerStars that, is there benefit for them in signing up a pro to promote through the WSOP in Australia? Well, they're again going to be hamstrung on what they can actually do to leverage a sponsorship. And I think until we get some sort of resolution again with this online issue that, online sponsorships are going to be few and far between, purely on the basis that there's just so little that you can do with the talent.
God, when you said zero like that, I know our show is podcast and listen to a lot of the Australian grinders. They like to play in the morning, and I can just hear like thousands of hearts shattering like in the next couple of weeks when they fire this podcast and hear that there's no sponsorship on opportunities for them.
Oh, well, I think it makes sense because a lot of the people that, like from my own perspective, coming from someone who was actually going for that one position, a lot of the, I would love if I could present myself as a real person and not an online character. I think that would be more beneficial to myself. But being an online person, the only way you can really present yourself is through your work, and that's things such as like blogging and training sites and things like that. But the people that are watching training videos and the people that are reading your blog as an online poker player are people that already play on the sites. So yeah, I, I definitely I definitely see Sean's point in regards to what can you offer, because you're not actually bringing in any new customers necessarily.
And it's a really tricky one for you guys going through a process like that. And I'm not sure what the basis of the brief was, but look, you know, I know Roy and, you know, have huge respect for him as a player, but from a business point of view, I'm thinking, well, what does having him on my site bring to my site? Is it going to bring extra players? Is it a little bit of credibility? Is it having a presence in a market that's diminished to some extent because of there's so little that we can do? And so I think it's all, you know, it would have been awkward for you guys. But look, Matt, I think there's it could be a great opportunity here for you, and that if you're energized by that process, that that, you know, follow it through and think the flip side of, you know, you clearly are, you know, you're a well-spoken, respected figure in the community, and you know, there may be something, you know, you get yourself prepared now, who knows what's going to happen 5-10 years down the track.
I'll be too old then. Yeah. A couple of quick last questions before we wrap up, just because I don't want to keep you for too long, and we have early scoops in the morning as well, I guess. Firstly, I did notice, and it was something that both these things are things that we touched on a little earlier, and the first one was I noticed that Poker Media has an affiliation with some pub poker leagues. And do you think that, like, that market in particular is one that should be, like, we have had a certain opinion, and I definitely get the understanding from speaking to you about the segmentation of the market and how it's different for everyone, both the online casinos and pub poker. But do you think that the online, the pub poker leagues and the pub poker players should be a little more sought after by online providers? I know that Triple Eight have an affiliation with the APL now, but it just seems like a market with, like, so much potential, but it doesn't really seem to be tapped properly.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. The problem with the pub, with getting to the pub poker market, is it needs to be grassroots. You need to be getting, you know, into the face of the players. And when you've got, you know, 50 or 100 people spread across thousands of venues across the country, it's tricky to find the right means to actually get to them. I think the 888 Poker League, obviously, with the naming rights, have done very well. And I think that they've been able to integrate the online element of 888 into their business without cutting their own throats, because the first thing a venue is going to say is, well, I don't want someone sitting at home playing poker. I want them here,
yeah,
eating chicken parmas and drinking beer and playing poker.
I do that at home as well.
Yeah. Probably a better example is with Full Tilt in Sydney with the MPL, where Rob Huxley did some really good on-the-ground promotions. They were in the venues regularly. They were in the players' faces. And I don't know the numbers, but from an outsider looking in, that looked like a really good campaign. So, in short, yes, I think that there's a huge opportunity for online sites to get in with the pub leagues. I think legislation and licensing would allow that to happen anyway. It's just tricky at the moment, because to do it, you need people working on the ground. You need physical staff to be able to go out and work in the venues and develop these opportunities. And that's probably the biggest hamstring for them at the moment.
Yeah, okay. I absolutely agree. Maybe the best way is to get the Poker Media magazine distributed through all the APL and the NPL and the whatever the next poker league is, and just whack a big online site throughout it and do it that way. I don't know.
If I could have PMA bet running tomorrow, boys, don't you worry about it.
Lastly, mate, unicorns or giraffes? No, I'm that's one of Chew's questions, sorry.
No, that's very mature.
The announcement of the World Series of Poker Australia, we discussed it last week, something that's come up a couple of times throughout the course of the interview. I know that you have your finger on this, and I know that you're excited like we are about it. Any little insider scoops? Do you have any feelings about how the schedule is going to look? And lastly, like, we had a little bit of conjecture over this last week. Do you think it's going to alienate the Aussie millions a little bit?
No, I don't think. The two big opportunities with the World Series is you'll get the clash with the PCA has been a big issue for the Aussie millions going back a decade. So you remove that for a start. So it's going to open up the avenue for a lot of players to come out in April that wouldn't come out in that January window. So I think that's a big plus. You're going to have people, there'll be a proportion who will say, I'm only going to come to the Aussie millions or I'm only going to come to the World Series. But I think that having a bigger focus on bringing players from Asia to Melbourne, which look, we really haven't done that well. If you have a look at the numbers, it's still players predominantly coming from Europe or the States to play in the Aussie millions. In the last couple of Aussie millions, we've seen the high rollers coming out from Macau, which has been great. But I think if we can sort of harness that certainly that core in Macau, Philippines, Malaysia, there's some great poker communities in Southeast Asia, now Koreans, Japanese. If we can start to get them coming out as well, I think both events benefit in the long run. But on the flip side, from a poker player's point of view, the schedules are going to have to complement each other. You know, I think it's going to be pretty stupid having a $250,000 buy-in tournament at the Aussie millions and then try and replicate it again at the World Series. But I think Crown are certainly aware of that. And so yep. I think we'll end up seeing two very complementary schedules, and you'll see a lot of interactivity between both events to ensure that they're both a success.
Okay. Well, hopefully they are. I hope to see. My biggest concern is that Aussie Millions is going to decline, but my ideal scenario is that all the beefs that came out this year, people like Mormon, Jakun, all the online guys that you just don't see that often, hopefully they don't come for the Aussie Millions, so that gives like grinders like us a chance, and then they can come for their bracelet chase while Matt and I can go deep in the main or something.
No, that's not going to happen. I'm not.
Well, I would have thought there are already two bracelets spoken for, so I don't know what you're worried about.
Yeah, Matt's got the ladies event.
Look, boys, I think there'll be some players who'll be drawn to the attraction of the bracelets over the money and such, but I just think they're going to be different enough, and I think Crown is smart enough to sort of think that, yeah, we've got to come up with two reasonably different schedules that cater for everyone. But it's just going to be a massively exciting time.
Yeah, that I can't wait till January kicks around and you just get that buzz going. Everyone from myself to just normal poker players get excited about it. Hopefully there's enough money floating around the Australian economy to be able to fund two big series, so we'll see how it goes.
I'll probably be Busto by then.
Probably.
Get a sponsor.
Yeah, Matt will be sponsored by... that could be a new segment. We'll get someone to like offer sponsorship deals to Matt. And we'll start low. We'll start at 50 cents, and you can change your avatar. You can be sponsored pro.
All right.
I'll put the first dollar down for a PMA badge.
Done. Someone has to beat a dollar. Matthew's avatar's for sale, $1.
It's a challenge.
Thank you so much for joining us tonight, mate. Thank you for spending so much time as well. We've kept you for pretty much an hour now, mate. It's been great to get some insight into someone that's been around for so long and has such a good depth of knowledge in everything that's involved with the industry. For those that are listening, where can they find your Poker Media online magazine? Where can they read your articles and stuff?
So pokermedia.com.au, we've got all our news feed updated daily. We've got the link through to the Real Deal magazine there. We're doing our best to get as many printed copies, so hopefully in your local casino poker room and pub poker games around the country, you'll start to see the magazine reappearing. And and selected events where we do some live reporting as well. So I know we're heading up to Canberra, and we'll be doing the Sydney Champs coming up a little bit later in the year, and most of the major pub tournaments as well. And it's just a great way to get out and meet the the players and the people who follow us. So I appreciate the opportunity to chat about what we're doing, and I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate you guys too, because I think your show's fantastic, and the more media and the more coverage we can get for poker, the better, and I think you're doing a terrific job.
Thank you very much.
We try sometimes. Also, do you have a Twitter account? I was trying to link it up earlier, and we can get some people following you there so they can see when stuff's released.
I must admit, I'm over the Facebook. The Twitter I find a bit of a battle, but we are up on Poker Media Aust is our Twitter account.
AUST.
And then we're AUST, and then we're on up on Facebook as well.
Ah, fantastic. All right, mate. Well, it's been a pleasure, and hopefully we'll be able to have you back on and maybe a bit later in the year when we maybe have made some positive moves in the either the politically or economically or maybe approaching World Series time. It'd be great to have a chat to you again around that time.
Yeah, happy to chat with you anytime, boys.
All right, mate. Thank you very much for joining us. We're going to take a quick break and come back and wrap up the show in just a moment.
Yeah.
We are back, I assume. Do we have a Matthew in the house? A little bit. Well, I'd like to take this time anyway to just give a shout out to a couple of people that have been bugging me for the last week, saying, oh, Convict Corner, I love it so much. And we do get that a lot. The number one man, I think, is Westy, who he missed out because we did a show when Matthew unfortunately couldn't make it and it didn't get put to podcast, where we did where we was to mention his warm up final table, and he's a big fan of the show and he didn't get his name in the light, so I've got to say, Mr. Westy,
thank you very much. I added him that week to the wrap up that I gave you.
Well, I just want to give him a shout out again. Who else we got? I know that Steznuts was bugging me today about the show, saying, hey man, when's it coming back on? I'm a big fan, very funny, so when you're listening to this podcast in the next couple of days, Steznuts, here's my shout out to you. And Mr. Moat, the other one I'll give a shout out to is Modi. Hello Modi. That's all I have to say. Matt? I think we are having slight troubles with Matt's audio. We do have, here we go, he's been disconnected. I don't know what much more we have. We do have like a few filtered bits of Ask Chew questions. I don't know that Matt is going to be available to help him. The one we had coming was from, I believe it was Lloyd. How important do you consider the ability to multi-table, and how does HEM/PokerTracker help to do so? What is the most important? What is the most imp of it? I don't know what kind of imps he's referring to, but I don't know. Multi-table is probably the most important thing. If you're a professional poker player, the most important thing you can do, because at the end of the day, it comes down to like dollars per hour rather than ROI. A lot of people misunderstand like profitability.
What are you talking about?
Oh, you missed it. Oh, look, he comes back. I had a question.
Skype dropped. We're not doing Ask Two.
I have a question. The people need to know.
It failed.
I have people at home saying, how many tables should I play? How important is multi-tabling? And, dude, they're not going to be able to sleep at night.
All right. I'm going to pull an end to this. I just wanted to say,
multi-tabling is important. It is very important. Okay. Do it.
Multi-tabling is important. A big thank you. Sorry, I didn't get the opportunity because my Skype decided to crash on me after the break. A big thank you to Sean for joining us tonight. It was really interesting to listen to a lot of the things he had to say. And for those that are listening, he did answer us off air that he is a draft man.
Yeah, that's quite I think that's almost the biggest story we had out of that interview. Confirmed draft man. There aren't many of them left.
Mate, but you and I, we both need to sleep because we've gone a long way over tonight and it's going to be a long podcast. So,
what length? I think this is the longest one we've done. Then again, that is probably the best interview and the best guest we've had on. So thanks again to Sean.
I mean, that's no disrespect at all to the other characters that we've had on. They've all had their own uniqueness.
Oh, we've had lots of big names of the grinding community, but it's interesting to get insight from someone who's involved in poker in a different way.
And one last thing. One thing I noticed didn't happen tonight. Zach did not play the Chew song.
Oh, so dude, you...
I'm hoping that he takes us out with the Chew song.
I think he's lost it.
Has not reared its ugly head tonight. Do you have anything else to say? Because I am going to get rid of us.
No, great show tonight, Matt. Good hustle.
Any more nice hustle, Shooter? No more Ask Chew questions. It's canned. Any attempt to bring Ask Chew back is gone. It's not happening.
Yeah. Okay.
We can try the quotes from Benny Money 18 next week, but the Ask Chew is gone. Done.
All right. Well, R.I.P.
All right. So for this week's Convict Corner, I am MJW006. That is Stephen Random Choo Choo, and we will speak to you guys next week.